Hi, OC. My name is Ngozi Ukweni. I'm an investment analyst with IFC and happy to be chatting and discussing with you today on the creative industry in Africa. Hi. So we'll start from the background. As a Nigerian, I understand how difficult it is to have those conversations with our family and friends on choosing a career in the creative industry. So tell us a little bit about your background. How did the conversation go? Were your friends and family receptive to you pursuing a career in the creative industry?
I have to be honest, I was very lucky. My mom let me do everything that I wanted to do. All of us learned a bit of independence earlier on, so it sort of let myself and my siblings, you know, go ahead and figure out what we wanted to do for ourselves. And I know that the narrative is usually that, you know, African parents frown at this, but I stayed in school, basically. I was studying marine sciences at the University of Lagos in Akoka, but I was doing theater. I was singing. I was doing all of that great stuff. And in that period, my mom just let me do it. It was when I was wrapping up with the university that, you know, then it becomes real because now they're like, okay, so what's your plan? You know, so I was looking for a sign, and fortunate for me, as I was wrapping up university, I got into a reality TV show that I won that sort of set me along the path of what I'm doing right now. So I didn't have to have that difficult conversation with my mom about, shall I go on with this? I mean, further along the line, they're asking you questions like, is this thing going to work? Are you sure? But I honestly had it easy. I'm one of the lucky ones.
Good to know. So what would you say to the average African creative who is struggling to have those conversations and to grow in their career? What would you say to encourage them, or how do they deal with such challenges?
I'll be honest with you. As long as your parents are paying the bills, I think that you should obey your parents to begin with. But the most important thing is, as you do whatever it is you're plugged into, whatever discipline you find yourself in, you must always find room to exercise that talent or that gift. And that's important because those are the hours that you plug into developing yourself through the period, so that when you get into the market or when you're old enough to step out on your own, you're not just starting the process of figuring out how to plug yourself into the industry. So just keep exercising that muscle. And then when you're done with school and when you're done with whatever it is your parents want you to do, you will find the windows that will open up to you.
I really appreciate giving us some experiences around how your career started. My next question is, what are some of the groundbreaking moments in your career, and what and who were instrumental to you launching yourself out in the creative industry?
I had a few groundbreaking moments, first of which was the reality TV show. This was done by Ansel Malta Box Office, and it was for actors, basically. And that sort of launched me into the market, so I didn't have to, you know, defend or prove to my parents and to people that I could do this, because that spoke for itself. And after that, the first film I made off of the reality TV show with Ansel Malta, I had this, you know, incredible award that I won, and that award, you know, was an Africa Movie Academy Awards, and that sort of positioned me a bit more, you know, seriously in the industry. So I wasn't looking like a newcomer anymore. And then the third point was going off to study in LA. You know, for me, that was important because, you know, I'd seen how we made film in Nigeria, and it was important for me to, you know, I guess, translate the gift into some sort of knowledge base, basically. And then by the time I came back and I did this other film and I won another award, these awards were pretty crucial because they set me up enough to be able to be celebrated across parts of Africa that helps you become a more visible face. And through that journey, there was Dozie Atoyi, who first of all explained who I was as a person and what I was doing on this earth. Honestly, that's the first time someone told me, these are the things you're good at and this is what you should pursue. And there was Peace I Am Osigwe, who flew me out the first time to Berlin to a film festival. There was Wang Imbauzo, who introduced me to all the business people in the business. There was Stella Damasos, who introduced me to all the senior colleagues in the business. There was Shala Olubi and Ayo Tuyelo, who financed, and Lolo Eremi, who financed my life in all that poverty-stricken period, basically. So these people really contributed to make sure that even though I was pursuing something that looked like it was difficult, I was able to do it freely, basically.
Yes, I appreciate that you mentioned that, because we need leaders in the creative industry to be able to help the young talent have path the way for them going forward. We have seen from our research that there's been a lot of demand for creative content from Africa on Netflix and Disney Plus. So I wanted to get your thoughts on this. Do you think that this is a very good opportunity for African content to be shown to the world? And what hope and opportunities does this have for the next generation of young African talents?
I think it's actually great. For me, I always think that anyone who, you know, in the value chain that is interested in getting, whether it's African films or African stories out there, I see them as collaborators. The other thing too is we also know that, you know, there are streaming platforms and online platforms in Nigeria and across Africa, but we all know that, you know, the Netflixes, the Amazons, you know, these are, you know, the giants in the space. And so for me, as long as we're getting the stories out there, you know, it's reducing the heterogeneous stories. Like, there are stories that are being told, not just from a part of the world, but across. And so there is the reception of these stories that people can identify with, whether you're Mexican, whether you're, as long as, you know, there is a culture base. So for me, it's good that that's happening. I think that the more important thing is, for those of us back home, to borrow a leaf from these models, because I think that ultimately, you know, these business platforms will service their end goals, which is good. And these end goals also benefit us. But I also think that we also need to start looking at our own end goals, because ultimately, we are the only ones who can decide how far our stories will go. Whether it is we make the quality to a certain level that we can compete across board, or we ramp up our distribution, ramp up our exhibition, whatever it is, all those aspects of the value chain need to be shot up, and we need to find those investors from the continent to make it easier for us to get out there as much as we can.
Thank you so much, OC. I appreciate that you're listing some of these key initiatives, and I want to dig down a little bit more. When you talk about the value chain, what are the gaps that you think that need to be filled? And in my own knowledge of the Nollywood industry and the film industry, I'm thinking, what are the key initiatives that needs to be put in place for Africans to take advantage of this online audience, that global audience that they have available?
Okay, so I think everyone who services, you know, the film industry has to approach it as a professional. It's really not a hobby. You can't come into the business and think you can do it haphazardly and get away with it, because again, you know, you have to look at it from, you know, one level playing field across the globe. And so education for me is important. You might be talented, but it's important for you to educate yourself. And I think that is a gap that we really need to fill, so that everyone who, you know, services it on the value chain knows exactly what is supposed to be done and is properly educated to approach the work as should be. So that when we understand that we're not doing anyone favors here, we're actually doing this for real. And then I think one of the biggest gaps is really, you know, building a structure, you know, specifically in Nigeria, but, you know, by extension in parts of Africa that have film markets, because this structure makes it easier for investors to come in, you know, whether it is based on policies, based on co-productions. Those structures are important to be in place so that these conversations are important or are easier to have, you know, whether it is you decide that you want to work with people who come from outside, or just to set up the structure for you guys to function properly in your own environment. So I think, without talking too much, those two are really important things that I think are gaps in the business we need to fill.
I'm glad you mentioned education because I keep wondering, is it going to be formal education, set up a film school or partner with an already existing university to set up a film academy, or is it going to be a vocational school? So what is your thought and exactly on the education? Because I know that there are a lot of talent in Africa that have this creative idea, but because of that lack of education, like you've mentioned, it's difficult for them to grow. So what's your idea in detail on education?
As far as that goes, I think all of the options that you've mentioned actually work. But in the absence of if, you know, you have, whether it's vocational, I think, first of all, approaching the craft as an actor means you have to be ready to educate yourself. As a filmmaker, you have, and this is the age of the internet, you can find a lot of things. I've done master classes online. You know, I've applied. So it's like, you can find these things online as long as you're looking for the resources that you need. It doesn't have to be, you know, in the four walls of a university or, you know, structured as it is, even though that is important because that also gives you the opportunity to be able to meet other filmmakers, whether in your space, to create networks around it, to make it easier for you to find people to, you know, collaborate with. So that is important, but it's also important that you as an individual approach the business by choosing to educate yourself and finding the resources, you know, online, and then finding, you know, distant learning. There's so many options of these things in this day and age. And then even for someone like me, just watching material is also a way to educate yourself, basically.
Thank you so much. I know you had mentioned structure, and I wanted to ask a question, a follow-on question to that. What do you think about equipment financing for creative in Africa? Because sometimes the concern is the quality of work that comes out from Africa being weak or low. So do you think that equipment needs to be financed for these creatives in this space?
I personally think that equipment is not an issue. I think that there, at least from my own very small viewpoint and circle of influence, I know a lot of people who have equipment. So I don't think that equipment is our problem. I think that translating the stories we have into actual gems in terms of screenplay, things that are enjoyable, things that last longer, things that have shelf lives, are the more important things. Because as far as it goes, you know, setting up equipment, or I mean, in this day and age where the iPhones and the Samsungs, people have used those to experiment and shoot films that have gone on to film festivals and been successful, you realize that in the absence of equipment, even just with the phones, people can tell stories. But the important thing is, what is the story that is being told? And so for me, financing equipment is, in my opinion, my little opinion and humble opinion, is not really what's important. I think what's important is educating us on how to move from story to actual scripts, because stories are great, but how you document those stories to become dialogue that becomes things that people will always remember, that people will always make reference to. For me, that's the most important thing. Growing up as a child, there are a lot of TV shows that I watched that they didn't use the best equipment, but it was the stories that stayed with us, so that when we remember those stories, that's what we remember. We don't remember how the lights was. We didn't care. We cared because we're invested in the stories and in the way the dialogue was told. So for me, that's what's more important.
Very, very true that you mentioned that. And I wanted to think a little bit back about the time when we are now, given the pandemic. How has the pandemic shaped the industry? What could have been done differently to help the industry survive a pandemic like this? And how has it changed your work? And how are you adapting, you know, in this time?
Right. Well, I don't know if I'm a complete authority as far as the pandemic affects work back at home, because I've been out in Toronto for a while. But if I speak from my experience here, thankfully, things have picked up now. Things were shut down for a bit because a lot of the protocols had to be figured out. But now things are circled back, and now people are spending more time doing self-tapes, you know, and then when you get past stage one and stage two, then they probably bring you in. But it was also a good time for a lot of people, you know, who wanted to either work on their own personal material, to start putting pen to paper. You know, it gave a lot of people as well the, I guess, the bravado to start recording some of their own stuff, because at the point nobody was hiring, you know. So people started creating their own content, putting it on their own channels and whatnot. And so that has sort of put people in the space where, apart from waiting for people to hire you, you start figuring out how it is you can create your content. And once you get an audience to that, it makes you realize how much more you can do. So for someone like me, I mean, I've chosen my own path, and for the time being, I'm more in front of the camera, and I've survived so far. I'm glad that I'm being hired, and, you know, we're just glad to still be in this space.
Good to hear that. That's very encouraging. My next question is going to be on the impact of the creative industry. Oftentimes, the film industry is seen as a form of entertainment, and therefore the impact is reduced. But can you speak a little bit more about job creation opportunity, how the film industry helps with societal values and growth and development of Africa as a continent?
Right. And you're absolutely right. I do agree. And the entertainment value is huge and it's important. And I celebrate that. But I know that one of the things that I learned in filmmaking when I grew up, when I was watching films, was this popular phrase. The Americans, we usually say in their films, we do not negotiate with terrorists. Now, I didn't know anything about America, but that's one thing I picked up from a film. And so I grew up thinking that Americans never negotiate with terrorists. And for me, that's one of the things that shows you how you can shape or model society based on the way that stories are told. And it doesn't have to be on the nose. Again, it's back to, in my opinion, how the story stays with the people, because those are the things that have longer lasting impact in terms of how you get across to your audience based off of how you have been able to convey your story without saying, oh, be a better person. Oh, no, no. It's just in the elements that you put in there, in the way you write the dialogue, in the way the actors get across each other, lets you know. And then some of the times you get the catch lines, Americans do not negotiate with terrorists. And that keeps your mind in a way where you look at Nigeria specifically, and by extension, Africa, very differently. You start thinking of how to become better people. And like you said, it's created jobs for a ton of people. It contributes greatly to the GDP of our system. Again, we're lacking structure in terms of how that entire cycle circles back into, you know, the pockets of the actors and the producers, you know, and the distribution channel. And I know that that you know, cycle is still a bit wobbly. But the most important thing is it is possible to do this as long as we're developing our stories into more memorable nuggets.
Yes, I agree with you, because I think there's a link between the film, the music, the fashion,
exactly,
when it comes all together. And those linkages need to be established to be able to help us to grow the creative industry as a
Absolutely.
Whole.
Absolutely.
I also thought about access to finance as a challenge that some creatives have brought to the table as part of the experiences that they've had. And I think about the commercial banks and how they are not able to support the creative industry as much as they would want to.
Right.
So let's
right.
talk a little bit about your experience. How has financing of films, based on your understanding, worked out? And what has been the appropriate ways or best practices that can be adopted in financing film projects?
I have to be honest, I need to salute everyone in Nigeria and by extension Africa who has made a film ever, because I think that we're doing magic, because largely financing has come out of people's pockets, basically. And this was before the commercial banks got into play. And basically even the terms of the commercial banks also makes it, you know, sometimes a little tricky to figure out if this is what is in, this is the way a filmmaker should go. So I think so far, you know, financing has been a serious challenge because, again, it's people pulling monies out of their pockets and hoping that something will happen. And I do think that as much as I know, there are structures we can build that facilitate. And this is, in my opinion, where a lot of the government comes in play, because in my little experience, even in places like Brazil and Sao Paulo, where I've been fortunate to do some business, you know, I know that one of the bigger topics for filmmakers was that their president was changing the way the government was financing or funding film. And for me, that was funny because that's not the experience we have back home. And so when you have governments in Brazil set up SESC, which allows for all the creatives to find a space to be able to do this, sometimes you hope that this is something that, you know, governments in Africa can also look into, because ultimately our business, when you think about, you know, tax credits that, you know, places like here always give, you know, to filmmakers and things, those are aspects that can come from individuals, will come from governmental organizations and commercial banks. And clearly, there are, you know, there are very many ways you can structure these deals that allow for filmmakers to not be afraid to approach you, so that you're not worried that you will spend the next 5, 6, 7, 10 years figuring out how to plug the money back into the system. Because again, our business is dicey, you know, and I understand that we have to be able to set it up as, you know, business that has numbers. But the only way we can start from where we are is by getting as much plug-in, in my opinion, from the government as much as we can. And, you know, ramping up the policies that allow for filmmakers to be able to find the spaces to do this, so that financing is not the issue for us to be able to tell these stories.
National financial institution that supports the private sector. So I want to know, in your opinion, how can the private sector play a role in supporting the creative industry, and how do you see the impact of the creative industry in financing the sector?
Honestly, I think that two aspects that, you know, the private sector can help, first of all, is ramping up the scale of education back at home. And the reason why education is important is because, you know, talent can take you to, you know, a distance, but it's important for you to know and have a holistic approach to the business. You know, for someone like me, I'm an actor, but I'm learning as much as I can as far as the business of filmmaking is concerned. So that if the private sector can come in and set up, you know, online courses, again, these are moving parts. These are things that can be figured out as you get into territories and figure out, you know, what is possible or what is easier to do. I think that educating us in approaching our work from a more global standard perspective is important. And I think those are parts of the places to plug the money into. I also think that as far as it goes with distribution, that is also a very important aspect that the private sector can come in. Because again, you can make a film and not know what to do with it. And I've been in films where, you know, they took a leap of faith and made a film. And after they made a film, they didn't know where to go. And so sometimes there are distribution channels, whether it's in Europe, or it's in North America, or it's in the Caribbean, that have a lot of, or that consume a lot of African content. And one individual doesn't know how to access that. But because these organizations, you know, have a network across the world, it's easier to find where these things can go and where these markets are, because the more those products are consumed, the easier it is for the producer to be at peace to, you know, make more films, the easier it is for the producer to pay the actors decent wages and pay every other person decent wages. And so for me, distribution is also a really important aspect that private organizations can come in and play.
Wanted to know, in your opinion, what are the top two challenges that need to be tackled for the African creative industry to get to the next level?
Distribution, for sure. And I'd still stick with education as well.
Yeah.
I'd stick with those
very
two.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I know that education is important, not just in the creative industry, but around other sectors as
Absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely.
And I think that we need to create a pipeline of these creatives so that they will be available to create content in the future going forward.
Yeah.
And now my final question is going to be, what is your word of encouragement for young creatives and young people in Africa that are looking to you and other players in the sector to grow their skill and improve their act in the creative industry?
Well, I mean, I'm going to say be intentional. First of all, it's important that if you come into this business at all, please be at least, at the very least, gifted in the thing that you're coming in to do. You know, have some sort of, you know, something, something that stands you out, you know, if it's the talent, if it's the interest, something. Be genuinely, you know, and then most importantly, be intentional. And it's intentional because our business is not a sprint. It is a marathon. And you have to be intentional about, you know, longevity. You have to be intentional about imagery. You have to be intentional about, you know, what your contribution to the global space is. You can't come into this business and just be, oh yeah, well, I'm just gonna be, you know, a good looking actor. You can't come in and do that. As a filmmaker, you also can't come in and do that. So I think that for young people out there, please be intentional when you come to this business. Figure it. I mean, you don't have to have all the answers from the beginning. Follow it through, but be intentional.
Thank you so much, Osi. It's been an amazing time chatting with you on the creative industry in Africa.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you very much. And thank you guys for giving me the opportunity to also be a part of this. I really appreciate it. Hey, my name is Osi Ukeje, and I would like you to join me on October 27th for IFC's Up Next, Inside Africa's Creative Industries. See you there.